Hello dear friends, this is your personal English coach Divyam here, and this is a continuation of my previous video, which is The Merchant of Venice, written by Shakespeare, Act 1. This video, I'll be covering Act 2. Act 2, Scene 1. Belmont, a room in Portia's house. Trumpets play. The Prince of Morocco, a brown-skinned man dressed in all white, enters, followed by three or four servants dressed in costumes like his. Portia, Nerissa, and their attendants enter. Don't hold my skin color against me. I was born and raised in the sun, which is why I'm dark-skinned. But I'm as red-blooded as any man. Show me the best-looking person born in the freezing month where the sun barely thaws the icicles. I'll win your love by cutting myself to prove you I have redder blood than he does. I'm telling you, madam, my skin color has made me brave men fear, and Moroccan girls love me. I wouldn't change it except to make you think of me, my darling queen. Being good-looking isn't the only way to my heart, you know. I have other criteria for choosing a husband. Not that it matters, because the box test takes away my free choice anyway. But if my father had not restricted me like this, forcing me to marry whoever wins his test, then you would have had as a good chance to marry me as any of the suitors I've met so far, Prince. Thank you for saying that. Show me the casket and let me try my luck. I swear by sword, which killed the Shah of Persia and Persian prince and defeated the Sultan Suleiman 3 times, that I would face the meanest looking warriors on earth. I would act braver than the bravest man on earth. I would grab bear cubs from ferocious mother bear or tease a hungry lion. All of this in order to win your love, lady. But this is bad. If the hero Hercules and his servant Lycus roll the dice, which would win? Not the greater hero, just the one who happened to be luckier that time. And just as Hercules could be beaten by his servant, blind luck could make me lose this test and make someone worse than me win. If that happened, I would die of sadness. You have to take your chances. Either don't choose at all, or swear beforehand that if you choose incorrectly, you will never talk about marriage to any woman again. Think about it carefully. Fine, I swear I won't ever get married if I choose incorrectly. Let me take my chances. Let's go to the temple first. You can take your chances after dinner. I'll try my luck then. I'll either be the luckiest or the unluckiest man alive. Trumpets play, they exit. Scene 2. Venice, a street. Lancelot enters alone. I'm sure I will feel guilty if I run away from this Jew, my master. That devil's on my shoulder, tempting me. He's saying, Gobbo, Lancelot Gobbo, good Lancelot, or good Gobbo, or good Lancelot Gobbo. Use your legs and run away. But my conscience says, no Lancelot, calm down, don't run away. The devil's urging me to leave. Go away, he says. Run away, be tough, says the devil, and run. But then my conscience, hanging around my heart, says very wisely to me, my good friend Lancelot, you're a good boy, the son of an honest man. Really, that should be the son of an honest woman, since my father cheated on my mother. Anyway, my concern says, stay put. Go, the devil says. Don't go, says my conscience. Conscience, I say, you give good advice. Devil, I say, you give a good advice. If I listen to my conscience, I would stay with the Jew, my master, who's a devil. But if I ran away from the Jew, I would be following the advice of the devil, who's the very devil himself. Certainly, the Jew is the devil incarnate, and my conscience is giving me a hard time by telling me to stay with the Jew. The devil's advice is nicer. I'll run, devil. Tell me to run, and I'll run. Gobbo enters with a basket. Excuse me, young man. How do I get to the Jew's residence? Launcelot speaks to himself. Good heavens, it's my father. He doesn't recognize me because he's half blind, or more than half blind, somewhere between half blind and totally blind. I'll play a little game with him. Young man, excuse me, how do I get to the Jews? Turn right at the next turn, but at the following turn, turn left. Oh, and then at the very next turn, don't turn left or right, but turn down and around to the Jew's house. Good heavens, those are difficult directions. Can you tell me if a man named Launcelot who lives with him is still there? Are you talking about young Master Launcelot? Launcelot speaking so no one else can hear. Watch out, I'm going to pull a good prank here. Is that who you're talking about? He's not a master, sir. He's just a poor man's son. His father, if I do say so myself, is an honest but very poor man, and thank God, likely to live a long time. Well, his father can be whatever he wants to be. We are talking about young Master Launcelot. Please don't call him that, sir. He's just Launcelot. But excuse me, ergo, old man, ergo, I'm asking you if you're talking about young Master Launcelot. Yes, I'm talking about Launcelot, sir. Ergo, Master Launcelot. But please don't talk about Master Launcelot, old man, the young gentleman submitting to the fates and three sisters who control destiny and other branches of learning like that is deceased, or to put it in plain language, he is gone to heaven. Oh no, God forbid, the boy was going to support me in my old age. What am I, a cane? How do I support anyone? Don't you recognize me, father? Heaven help me, I don't know you, sir, but please tell me, is my boy, God rest his soul, alive or dead? You really don't recognize me, father? Sir, I'm half blind. I don't know you. Even if you had your eyes, you still might not recognize me. It takes a wise father to know his own child. Well, old man, I'll tell you news of your son. Give me your blessing. The truth will come to light, and murder can't be hidden long. A man's son may hide, but truth will always come out. Please stand up. I'm sure you aren't Launcelot, my boy. Come on, quit fooling around. Give me your blessing. I am Lancelot. Who was your boy? Is your son and will be your child. I cannot believe you are my son. I don't know what to say to that, but the fact is I am Lancelot, the Jew's servant, and Marguerite, your wife, is my mother. Yes, you're right. Her name is Marguerite. If you're Lancelot, then you're my own flesh and blood. Gobbo feels the back of Lancelot's head. My lord, what a bushy beard you have. You've got more hair on your chin than Dobbin my horse has in his tail. Then Dobbin's tail must be growing backward. I'm sure he had more hair on his tail than I have on my face when I last saw him. Lord, how you've changed. How you and your master are getting along. I've brought him a present. How are you? I'm all right, but I've decided to run away and I can't wait to get going. My master's total Jew. You're giving him a present? Give him a noose to hang himself. He is starving me to death. You can see my ribs so well, you can count them. I'm glad you have come, father. Give me your present to give Master Bassanio. He gives his servant beautiful new uniforms. If I can't get a job with him, I'll run away to the ends of the earth. Oh, look, this is lucky. Here he comes, Master Bassanio, now. Let's go talk to him. Father, if I work for the Jew any longer, you can just call me Jew. Bassanio enters with Leonardo and attendant or two. Bassanio speaks to the attendant. All right, go ahead. But do everything quickly. Super. It is nice. The dinner must be ready at 5. At the latest, make sure these letters get delivered. Get the uniforms made and tell Graciano to come visit me soon. The attendant exits. Go, talk to him, father. Gobbo speaks to Bassanio. God bless you, sir. Thank you. What do you want with me? This is my son, sir. He's a poor boy. Not a poor boy, but a rich Jew's servant who wants, as my father will explain. He wants very much, sir, as one might say, to work for. To put it briefly, I work for the Jew, and I want, as my father will tell you. He and his master aren't exactly friends. To be brief, the truth is that the Jew has done me wrong, and that forces me to, as my father and old man will inform you. I have a present I would like to give you, sir, and I want to request that. To make a long story short, the request is about me, and this good old man will tell you. Even though I'm his son and I'm the one saying it, this old man is a poor man. One of you do the talking. What do you want? To work for you, sir. That's what we are trying to say, sir. I know who you are. You can have what you want. I spoke with your master Shylock today, and he recommended you to me. If you want to leave a rich Jew to work for a poor gentleman, you're welcome to. Do you know the old proverb, the grace of God is enough, sir? it could be divided between you and my boss Shylock. You have the grace of God and he has enough. Nicely put. Go with your son, old man. Say goodbye to your old master and find your way to my house. Bassanio speaks to his attendants. Give him a uniform that's a little nicer than others. Make sure it gets done. Father, go ahead. I can't get a job, can I? I can't talk well. No. Lancelot reading his own palm. If any man in Italy has a palm good enough to swear on the Bible with, it's me. I've got very good luck. Here's my lifeline. It shows few wives. 15 wives is nothing. 11 widows. 9 maids is a humble beginning for one man. It seems I'll almost drown 3 times and my life will be in danger when I'm caught in bed with another man's wife. But these little lines are escape routes I can take to get out of that one. If luck's a lady, she's good at this business. Father, let's go. I'll leave the dew behind in the blink of an eye. Lancelot and Gobbo exit. Please, Leonardo, think about this. Bassanio hands him a piece of paper. These things have been bought and are ready. Hurry back here. I'm having dinner tonight with someone I greatly respect. Go now. I'll do my best. Reggiano enters. Reggiano speaks to Leonardo. Where is your master? He's walking over there, sir. And then Leonardo exits. Signor Bassanio. Reggiano. I have a favor to ask. Anything. Don't say no. Let me go with you to Belmont. Well, if you have to go, you have to go. But listen to me, Graciano. Sometimes you get a bit too wild and you let your voice get a bit loud and rude. These things look good on you, of course, and to people like you and me, there's nothing wrong with it. But in places where people don't know, your behavior might seem too weird. Please try to act a little more serious or the people in Belmont will get the wrong impression about me. And your wildness will make me blow my chance with Portia. Listen, Signor Bassanio, there's nothing to worry about. I'll be solemn looking, I'll talk with respect, and I'll only swear once in a while. I carry prayer books in my pocket and look sweet even more. While grace is being said, I'll be modest and say, Amen. I'll watch my manners as if I'm trying to please my grandma. If I don't do all this, never trust me again. Well, we'll see how you act. Okay, but tonight doesn't count. You can't judge me based on what I do tonight. No, it would be a shame for you to act serious tonight. I'd rather see you having fun. Because we have friends coming who want to have fun. Anyway, I have to say goodbye to you now. I've got some business to take care of. I have to join Lorenzo and others. But we will visit you at the supper time. Then they exit. Act 2, Scene 3. The same. A room in Shylock's house. Jessica and Lancelot enters. I'm sorry you're leaving my father like this. It's hell in our house and you helped cheer it up like a funny devil. But goodbye. Here's the ducat for you. You'll soon be meeting Lorenzo at the supper. He'll be a guest for your new master. Give him this letter. Jessica gives Lancelot a letter. Do it secretly. Goodbye. I don't want my father to see me talking to you. Goodbye. My tears show you my feelings, my beautiful pagan, my sweet Jew. I'm sure some Christians will resort to trickery to get you. But goodbye. It's not manly to cry. Goodbye. Goodbye, Lancelot. Lancelot exits. Oh God, what a heinous sinner I am, being ashamed to be my father's child. But I need to remember I'm related to him by blood, not by behavior. Oh Lorenzo, if you keep your promise to me, I'll end this agony by becoming a Christian and marrying you. She exits. Scene 4. The same. A street. Graciano, Lorenzo, Salarino, and Solenio enters. No, we will sneak away at supper time, disguise ourselves with masks at my house, and come back in an hour. But we haven't made any preparations. We haven't even talked about who will be our torchbearers. The masquerade party might turn out terribly if we don't manage these things carefully. I think it's better to call it off. It's only 4 o'clock now. We have 2 hours to get ready. Lancelot enters with a letter. Lancelot, what's going on? Lancelot gives Lorenzo the letter. If you don't mind opening this letter, you can find out for yourself. I recognize the handwriting. It's beautiful handwriting. And beautiful hand that wrote this letter is whiter than paper it's written on. I bet it's a love letter. Lancelot to Lorenzo. May I be excused, sir? Where are you going? To invite my former boss, the Jew, to dine tonight with my new master, the Christian. Lorenzo gives Lancelot money. Hold on, take this. Tell Jessica I won't fail her. Tell her in private. Go, gentlemen, get ready for masquerade tonight. I have someone who can be my torchbearer. Lancelot leaves. Me too. And so I will. Meet me and Graciano at this house in about an hour. It's good we are doing this. Salarino and Solenio exits. Wasn't that letter from Jessica? I have to tell you everything. She's told me how I can get her out of her father's house. She's also told me what gold and jewels she owns, and she's described the page's uniform she's keeping to wear as a disguise. If her father ever goes to heaven, it will be because his daughter's good. She'll never be punished with the bad luck unless it's because her father is an unbelieving Jew. Come with me. Lorenzo gives Graciano the letter. You can look this letter over as you go. Beautiful Jessica will be my torchbearer. And then they exit. Act 2, Scene 5. The same, before Shylock's house. Shylock and Launcelot enters. Well, you'll see it with your own eyes. You'll see the difference between working for Shylock and working for Bassanio. Shylock calling for his daughter. Jessica, you won't eat like a pig, like you used to do at my place. Jessica, and sleep, and snore, and wear your clothes out. Jessica, I'm calling you. Jessica. Who asked you to call her? I'm not asking you to call her. You always loved to tell me I couldn't do anything without being told. Jessica enters. Did you call me? Do you need something? I've been invited to supper, Jessica. Here are my keys. But why should I go? I wasn't invited because they like me. They're just flattering me. But I will go out of spite and to feed off the wasteful Christian. Jessica, my girl, watch the house. I don't feel like going. Things aren't going my way right now. I know because I dreamed of money bags last night. Please go, sir. My new master is expecting your approach. And I'm expecting his reproach. And they have been plotting things together. I'm not saying you'll get a masquerade party, but if you do, I predicted it. I knew there would be a masquerade when I got that bad omen of a bloody nose last Easter Monday at 6 in the morning. 4 years after I got the same kind of bloody nose on Ash Wednesday in the afternoon. What? There's going to be a masquerade? Listen to me, Jessica. Lock my doors up, and when you hear the drum and the nasty squealing of the flute, don't climb up the windows. Don't stick your head out in the public street to stare at the Christian fools with painted faces. Block up my house's ears. I mean the windows. Don't let the noise of shallow fools enter my serious house. I swear, I'm in no mood to go out to dinner tonight, but I'll go anyway. Launcelot, go. Tell them I'm come. Tell them I will come. I'll go ahead of you, sir. Launcelot speaks to Jessica. Mistress, be on the lookout when you're staring out the window. A Christian's coming who will be worth a Jew's glance. Launcelot exits. What did that gentle fool say to you? He said, goodbye, madam, and nothing else. The fool's nice enough, but he's such a huge eater and slow as a snail when he works. He sleeps all day like a cat. Bees that don't work can't stay in my hive, so I'm letting him go, handing him off so he can waste money for his new boss. The man who borrowed money from me. Anyway, Jessica, go inside. I might come back soon. Do as I told you. Shut the door after you. As the saying goes, lock things up and you'll get to keep them. He exits. Goodbye. If luck's with me, I'll lose a father and you'll lose a daughter. She exits. Scene 6. The same. Reggiano and Salerino enters. Dress for masquerade ball. This is the roof under which Lorenzo said to meet him. He's late. Yes, and that's surprising because lovers are usually early. Yes, for new lovers, time passes 10 times faster than for couples who have been married forever. That's always true. Who gets up from a meal with the same appetite he had when he sat down? can any horse retrace his footsteps with the same energy he had when he walked them for the first time? We chase everything in life more excitedly than we actually enjoy it when we get it. It's like a ship sails out of its harbor with all its flags waving, gently pushed by the wind. When that ship returns, her timber is all weather-beaten and her sails are ragged. The same wind makes the ship thin and poor. Here comes Lorenzo. We'll talk about this later. Lorenzo enters. My dear friends, thank you for your patience. I had business that made me late. When you have to steal your own wife someday, I'll wait for you just as long. Come over here. My future father-in-law, the Jew, lives here. Hey, who's in there? Jessica appears above, disguised as a boy. Who are you? Tell me so I can be sure. Though I swear I recognize your voice. I'm Lorenzo, your love. Lorenzo, that's for sure. And I'm also sure you're my love. Who else do I love so much? And now, but who knows whether I'm yours? As God is my witness, you know you're mine. Here, catch this box. It will be worth your while. I'm glad it's nighttime and you can't see me. I'm ashamed of my disguise. But love is blind and lovers can't see the silly things they do around each other. If they could, Cupid himself would be embarrassed to see me dressed up as a boy. Come down here. You have to be my torchbearer for the masquerade. What? I have to hold a candle up so that people can see what I'm doing? The truth is, I'm behaving like a loose woman. The torchbearer is supposed to bring light and love, but I should be hidden away in the dark. You're hidden away, sweetheart, dressed up like a boy. Come on quickly, time flies at night. We are late for Bassanio's feast. I'll lock up the doors, grab some more jackets, and be with you right away. Jessica exits from above. My God, she can't be a Jew. She's too nice. God, I'm crazy about her. She's wise if I'm judging her right. She's beautiful if my eyes can see. And she's loyal, as she has proven. And as long as she's herself, wise, beautiful, and faithful, she'll always have a place in my heart. Jessica enters. Ah, you're here. Come on, gentlemen, let's go. Our masquerade mates are waiting for us. Lorenzo, Jessica, and Celerino exit. Antonio enters. Who's there? Signor Antonio? Graciano, where's everybody? It's 9 o'clock. Our friends are all waiting for you. There's no masquerade tonight. The wind is blowing right. So, Bassanio's going onward immediately. I've sent 20 people to look for you. I'm glad I want to head out tonight. And then they exit. Scene 7. Belmont. A room in Portia's house. Trumpets play. Portia enters with the Prince of Morocco and both their entourages. Portia speaks to servant. Go, open the curtains and show the different boxes to the prince. A curtain is drawn, showing three caskets, one gold, one silver, and one lead. Portia speaks to Morocco. Now make your choice. The first one, the gold one, has an inscription that says, "He who chooses me will get what many men want." The second one, the silver one, says, "He who chooses me will get what he deserves." And the third one is made of dull lead. It has a blunt warning that says, "He who chooses me must give and risk all he has." How will I know if I choose the right one? One of them contains my picture. If you choose that one, I am yours, along with the picture. I wish some god could help me choose. Let me see. I'll look over the inscription again. What does the lead box say? "He who chooses me must give and risk all he has." Must give everything. For what? For lead? Risk everything for lead? This box is too threatening. Men who risk everything hope to make profits. A golden mind doesn't bend down to choose something worthless. So I won't give or risk anything for lead. What does the silver one say? "He who chooses me will get as much as he deserves." As much as he deserves. Wait a minute there, Morocco, and consider your own value with a leveled head. If your reputation is trustworthy, you deserve a lot, though maybe not enough to include this lady. But fearing I don't deserve her is a way of underestimating myself. As much as I deserve Portia. By birth, I deserve her, in terms of wealth, talents, and upbringing, and especially love. I deserve her. What if I went no further and choose this one? But let's see once more what the gold one says. "He who chooses me will get what many men want." That's Portia. The whole world wants her. They come from four corners of the earth to kiss the shrine and see this living, breathing saint. Princes travel across deserts and the vast wilderness of Arabia to come see the beautiful Portia. The wide ocean doesn't prevent them from coming to see her. They travel across it as if it were a little stream. One of these little boxes contains her lovely picture. Could the lead one contain it? No, it'd be a sin to think that such a low thought. It would be a sin to think such a low thought. Leads too crass to hold her. Is she enclosed in silver, which is 10 times less valuable than gold? Oh, what a sinful thought. Nobody ever set a gem like her in a worse setting than gold. They have a coin in England stamped with the figure of an angel, but that's just engraved on the surface. Here an angel's lying in a golden bed. Give me the key. I will choose this one and try my chances. She hands him a key. There, take it, Prince. And if my picture's in there, then I'm yours. Morocco opens the golden casket. Morocco. Damn it. What's this? It's a skull with a scroll in its empty eye socket. I'll read it aloud. Morocco starts reading. "All that glitters is not gold." You've often heard that said. Many men have sold their souls just to view my shiny surface. But gilded tombs contained worms. If you'd been as wise as you were bold, with an old man's mature judgment, you would not have had to read this scroll. So goodbye, you lost your chance. Lost my chance indeed. So goodbye hope and hello despair. Portia, goodbye to you. My heart's too sad for long goodbyes. Losers always leave quickly. Good riddance. Close the curtains and leave. I hope everyone looks like him will make the same choice. And then they exit. Moving on to scene 8. Venice, a street. Salerno and Solenio enters. I saw Bassanio sail away and Graciano went with him. I'm sure Lorenzo isn't on their ship. That wicked Jew got the Duke to listen to his complaints. The Duke went with him to search Bassanio's ship. He got there too late. The ship was already sailing. But once he got there, the Duke learned that Lorenzo and his lover Jessica were together in gondola. In any case, Antonio assured the Duke they were not with Bassanio on his ship. I've never heard such confused emotions as what that Jew dog was shouting in the streets. My daughter, oh my ducats, oh my daughter, ran off with the Christian, oh my Christian ducats, Jesus, the law, my ducats and my daughter, a sealed bag, two sealed bags of ducats, of double ducats, stolen from me by my daughter, and jewels, two stones, two rich and precious stones, stolen by my daughter. Justice, find the girl. She has the stones on her and the ducats. I know, all the boys in Venice are following him, yelling, his stones, his daughter, and his ducats. I hope Antonio repays his loan on time or he will suffer for this. That's a good point. I spoke with a Frenchman yesterday who said that a Venetian ship loaded with a treasure was wrecked in the English Channel. I thought about Antonio when he told me. I silently hope it wasn't his ship. You should tell Antonio what you hear, but don't do it suddenly, because it might upset him. There is no nicer guy in the whole world. I saw Bassanio and Antonio say goodbye. Bassanio told him he'd try to hurry back. Antonio answered, "Don't rush. Don't do a sloppy job for my sake, Bassanio. Stay until everything is finished. As for the Jew's contract, don't let it be a factor in your plans. Be happy and concentrate your thoughts on love and how to win your love." Then his eyes started tearing up. He turned his face away. Then he shook Bassanio's hand affectionately and they separated. I think he only loves life because of Bassanio. Let's go find him and cheer him up. Yes, let's do that. Then they exit. Scene 9. Belmont, a room in Portia's house. Nerissa and a servant enter. Hurry, hurry, close the curtain, quick. The Prince of Aragon has taken his oath, and he's coming to make his choice now. Trumpets play, the Prince of Aragon, his entourage, and Portia enter. Aragon, I swore I'd do three things. First, I can never tell anyone what box I choose. Second, if I choose the wrong box, I'll never propose marriage for the rest of my life. And third, if I pick the wrong box, I leave immediately. So, these were spoken by Aragon. And before that, Portia says, "Look, here are three boxes, Prince. If you choose the one that contains my picture, we will be married right away. But if you fail, you have to leave immediately. No pleas will be allowed." Everyone who comes to gamble on the game, that is, winning me, has to swear to these three rules. He who chooses me will get what many men want. What many men want that many could mean that most people are fools and choose by whatever is flashy. They don't go beyond what their eyes see. They don't bother to find out what's on the inside. Just like those birds called martins who build their nests on the outside of walls. People pay too much attention to what's on the outside. So I won't choose what many men desire, because I won't jump on the bandwagon and include myself, the whole crude population. So I guess it's you, you silver treasure house. Tell me once more what you say. He who chooses me will get what he deserves. That's nicely put, because who's going to cheat luck and get more than he deserves? No one should have an honor he doesn't deserve. Oh, wouldn't it be great if property, rank, official positions, and other honors were earned only by merit, not by corruption? There wouldn't be too many important men then. How many people who are humble now would be great then? How many people who give orders now would have to take orders? How many noble men would be weeded out and would become peasants? And how many common people would suddenly shine with nobility? Well, let me get back to my choice. He who deserves me will get what he deserves. I'll assume I deserve the very best. Give me the key for this one. I'll unlock my fate here in the second. He opens the silver casket. You thought about it too long, considering what you found there. What's this? A picture of an idiot holding a scroll up for me to read. I'll read it. It looks so unlike Portia. This outcome isn't what I hope for or what I deserve. The one who chooses me will get what he deserves. Didn't I deserve anything more than a fool's head? Is this my price? Don't I deserve more than this? Judging what you deserve is one thing. Offending you is something very different. So I will keep my mouth shut. What does this say? Dragon reads, this box was tested in the fire 7 times. The person who never makes a wrong choice has wisdom that will stand the test. Some people kiss shadows. They only feel the shadow of joy. There are fools out there with silver hair and silver coins. This choice was as foolish as they are. Take whatever wife you want to bed with you. You will have a fool's head forever. So go away. You're done here. The longer I stay, the more foolish I look. I came here with a fool's head on my shoulders, and now I'm leaving with two. Goodbye, sweet lady. I keep my oath and patiently suffer through my anger. He exits with his train. These men are like moths, drawn to these boxes as if they were flames. This is how the candles burn. The moth. Oh, these fools. When they choose, they only know how to lose. You know what they say, destiny chooses when you'll die and who you'll marry. Come on, close the curtain, Nerissa. A messenger enters. Where's Lady Portia? Here, how can I help you, sir? Madam, a young Venetian man has arrived to tell us his master is about to arrive. This lord has sent gifts. Beside his nice polite greetings, his gifts are expensive. I haven't seen such a promising candidate for your love. This servant has arrived before his master, the way sweet spring day hints about a lush summer. But there's never been an April day as promising as this. Please don't tell me anymore. I'm almost afraid you're going to tell me he's a relative of yours, because you are going so crazy praising him. Come on, Nerissa. I want to go see this man who's come so courteously. I hope it's Bassanio coming to win Portia. And then they exit. Dear friends, this is the end of Act 2. So, I hope you've understood it. If in case you have doubts, do mention it in comment section and I will be more than happy to solve them. If you've understood and if you think this was really helpful, do like my video. Most importantly, subscribe to my channel so that you get the latest updates. And the next video will have Act 3, all the scenes. I thank you for watching, listening, and understanding this video, and I hope you have a wonderful day.